Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. I want to thank Connor and the team for the invitation. Always a real privilege to represent our service in London, and it's been great to see so many friends from Cork and the outer counties. Connor's given me three talks over the next 2 days about topics that I'm really passionate about and get very excited, and quite frankly, can bang on for hours about. So the chances of me surviving this sort of Pokemon challenge are zero, so you can all relax. I won't get to the end of this lecture. If you want to hear what happens, you can ask me outside, or better still, in the pub a bit later on, and you can find out what happens. So the first talk I've been given is about Reboa. What are we going to do over the next few minutes? Well, hopefully I'll explain to you what it is, a little bit about the history, what it actually does to an individual, why should you actually think about doing it, and whether it's effective or not. So what is it? Well, quite simply, it's about the use of a balloon and sticking a balloon into the aorta in some way or other. But the key points about it are that it's a temporizing phenomenon, that it isn't definitive. You need to get the patient to some form of definitive care as quickly as possible. The other key point about it is that it's using non-compressible hemorrhage. So as the previous talkers, speakers have said, if you can use some form of tourniquet or you need to undertake a thoracotomy, that's what should take place. It shouldn't just take away all types of treatments for exsanguinating hemorrhage. Like everything in life, it's been used before. The first description was back in the 50s by Lieutenant Colonel Carl Hughes, working for the US Army, where he used this balloon here in a handful of soldiers that were wounded in the Korean War, where he placed it under direct vision into the aorta, again trying to stem the bleeding of a few group of patients that were absolutely bleeding to death. And of course, in those early examples, it wasn't successful, but it did set the seeds of something that could be used in exsanguinating hemorrhage. If you look into the literature, you might find Reboa under several different guises. Most of the time, it's entitled intra-aortic balloon occlusion. And it's been used in very different types of hemorrhage, from obstetric hemorrhage, where postpartum hemorrhage has gone wrong after the delivery of a baby. But it's also been used electively in placenta previa. It's been used in hepatic biliary surgery. It's been used in pelvic surgery, but the term Reboa seems to be restricted just for its utilization in trauma patients that are exsanguinating. And of course, you know, that may change with time. So what does it do? Well, on this slide, all the green bits are good, all the red bits are bad, but the idea is that you stick a balloon into the aorta that stops the bleeding below that point and hopefully maintains the blood pressure and maintains perfusion of organs here, but it also increases systemic vascular resistance, which means that, quite frankly, the blood pressure hopefully goes up. And what we do know, if you put it high up in the aorta in zone 1, and I'll come on to that in a minute, the blood pressure can bounce literally from 50 to 150 the minute the balloon goes up. But hopefully that allows the important organs, the central organs of the body, to be perfused. But like everything in life, there is a downside. And of course, everything below this balloon is no longer being perfused. And it's as there's no oxygen being delivered to those tissues, they become acidotic. You ostensibly have bad blood below it. And of course, that causes the ischemia can cause tissue necrosis and exacerbate cellular dysfunction. So there's a tipping point that you can only use the balloon for so long. Does it work? Well, there's animal data, lots of animal data out there in various guises that shows there is improved survival from this technique. Does it work in humans? Well, again, there aren't any randomized controlled trials. But there are a few handful of case reports from the French group where it's been used in pelvic trauma. Some of those patients died, But one of the key points about studying this particular intervention is it's only really being used in patients that are exsanguinating to death. They have a very high chance of dying. Another paper that came out of the US last year showed several patients, a mixture of placements of the balloon, open and closed. And again, some of the patients survived, some of them didn't. The authors felt the ones that were going to die, were going to die anyway. So what about the access? Well, you can access it through the arm, you can access it through the femoros, through the femoral vessel. That might be open, it might be closed, and it may be through percutaneous means with the use of ultrasound. We divide the aorta into three zones, really, because different things happen at different where you place the balloon in different areas of those. When you place the balloon in different areas, it has different effects. The key point is to remember that the aorta is not a tube, it's different sizes at different positions, and that dictates what sort of balloon you put in. Is it ready for pre-hospital care? Well, we do know that 30 to 80% of deaths are pre-hospital. We do know that non-compressible hemorrhage is the leading cause of death for those patients. These are the indications that we're using in zone 3, pelvic injury, lower limb, junctional injury, blunt or penetrating, big injuries like this pelvis. This is the procedure that we use percutaneous using ultrasound. Has to be part of a wider package where we use blood, tranexamic acid, has to be integrated into the hospital. Once you get in there, you can check that it's there by loss of pulses, and you can ultrasound the balloon, or you can use plain films to let you know you're there. Of course, there are complications. You can put it in the wrong place. You can put it in the wrong vascular tree. All of these problems can create, all of these side effects are experienced. The key point is that there's a lot of inertia in this group of patients. You've got to keep the patients moving, get the patients to IR or to theatre or to hospital. Does it work? It's not as easy as you might think at the end of the day. These patients are exsanguinated. It's not like PCI. Getting into the femoral artery isn't as easy as we had thought. We've only done 5 in the hospital. We've only done 1 pre-hospital, which was actually last weekend. And despite of an iron excess of 59 and no measurable blood pressures on scene, this chap's now alive and gone back for his pelvic surgery virtually in an elective fashion. So hopefully it does have a role. I'm going to finish there and thank you for your attention.